Welcome to Magic Arcanum. I'm Ryan Gomez. Behind the scenes is Nicole Letson, and we are so glad you are here because it's story time. Ikoria, Lair of Behemoths, is upon us, and it introduces a new plane and a new planeswalker to the magic story. So today, we're going to cover everything that happens in this exciting new place. But first, let me say a quick thank you to everyone who helps make this show possible with their support on Patreon. I invite you to join the fun by using the link down below. That can get your name in the credits and let you vote on the topics for future episodes. Okay, so what happens in Ikoria, Lair of Behemoths? Well, it turns out it depends who you ask. The set tells one version of the story through its own cards, but the official book, called Sundered Bond by Django Rexler, puts a different spin on several key events. For this video, I will be looking at the official story spotlight cards because I believe, as a card game, you should be able to follow things just from those. But I will also point out where they diverge from the book, and you can find links to all of the reference materials in the description under this video. Okay, so let's start with the setting, which is the Plane of Ikoria, an entirely new place for the magic story to take us. Ikoria's defining features are its monsters. They come in all sizes and types, but the thing they have in common is being a threat to the humans of the plane. The humans live in giant cities called sanctuaries, each with their own method of defense. Most of the action in our story takes place in and around Dranith. That's the largest and most heavily fortified of all the sanctuaries. Dranith is the home of Luca, the book's main character, and the set's new planeswalker character, although he is not a planeswalker at the beginning of the story. Luca is a captain in the Coppercoats. That's the military force employed by Dranith to detect and defeat monsters. The city does have high walls and archers and ballista towers, but their main method of defense is to send soldiers outside to intercept monsters before they can even get close to the city. Okay, so now that we've got the lay of the land, we can start talking about the actual story. The set does include 5 spotlight cards, but those by themselves tell you almost nothing. The official story website, which again is in the links down below, does include some honorary story spotlight cards, so we will be following that list for the rest of this video. Which means we'll be starting with Vivian. It's a little weird to me because Vivian doesn't actually appear until about a quarter of the way through the story, but it's almost like they were afraid to have a new character be the face of the set, so they kind of wedged Vivian at the front to give us someone familiar. Vivian Reed is a human planeswalker from a plane called Scala, which was destroyed by the dragon planeswalker Nicol Bolas. Vivian carries the Arcbow, a weapon that contains the essence of many different animals, and she's always looking to add to that collection to boost its power. She's on Ikoria to study the monsters, but as a person of nature herself, she does not want to cause them any harm. So that explains Vivian's presence for now. The second story card is Luca himself, so we can talk about him some more. There is nothing in the set to tell you that Luca is not a planeswalker at the beginning of the story, nor that he becomes one at the end, but that is what happens. Luca has lived his whole life on Ikoria, and he is a well-respected member of the Coppercoats, at least as things get rolling. He looks up to a man named General Kudrow, who happens to be our third story spotlight card. The general oversees all of the defenses for Dranith, and he depends on Luca and his squad of specials to engage monsters outside of the city walls. It's not super clear to me how politics work on Ikoria, but it seems like the general is in charge of truly everything. He is never challenged by any king or noble or elected representative of the people. Instead, he just calls the shots for everything, and that kind of power means he is probably more dangerous than any of the monsters we end up seeing. Anyway, there's one more character we have to introduce before we can start talking about the story, and that is the flying cat monster. Yeah, it is represented by this common you'll find rolling around in the middle of your booster pack, and the flavor text makes it sound like Luca took an immediate liking to this guy, but The book tells a very different story. To explain, I need to show you the first legitimate story spotlight card, Tentative Connection. This one doubles down on Luca making friends with the flying cat monster and suggests that it is the core of the entire story for Ikoria. In the sacred texts, however, this cat slaughters a ton of coppercoats, including most of Luca's own squad, before nearly killing Luca himself. In either case, the next story spotlight card does work, and that's Sanctuary Lockdown, which tells us that General Kudrow has turned against Luca and believes him to now be a traitor. That gets explained a lot better in the book. Basically, General Kudrow hates monsters. That's easy enough to understand. But he has also heard lately some humans are forming bonds with monsters. And to him, that is much more dangerous. Like Batman taught us, you always fear what you do not understand. On the cards, it seems like bonders have been around for a while, but in the book, it makes them sound like a much more recent development, and that's what has the general so worried. At any rate, the general decides Luca must be one of these bonders, because why else would the cat stop in the middle of its attack? That's why Kudrow orders Luca to be killed, and that's why Luca makes a daring escape from Dranith, fleeing for his own life. This takes us to Thwart the Enemy, which is a combination of several smaller scenes from the book. After escaping the city, Kudrow sends a squad of mercenaries after Luca, believing that as long as he's alive and working with the monsters, he is a threat. And this is where Vivian first enters the story. In the book, she's present and helps Luca escape the city guards, but she's also there when the mercenaries do catch up to them, so I'm okay with them kind of squishing all that together into one card. What is not shown here, though, is that the flying cat monster also returns and helps Vivian and Luca escape from those mercenaries. I should pause here and clarify a few things. At this point, Luca is still hopeful he can return to the city. His plan right now is to kill the cat and prove that he is a loyal human and not a dirty bonder, and get back onto General Kudrow's good side. But after being rescued by the cat, he has a vision of the Ozolith. This is a giant crystal located somewhere far north of Dranith, and he realizes the Ozolith is causing the monsters of the plane to be aggressive towards the humans. So then his plan switches. He wants to use the cat to reach the Ozolith and then see if his bond that worked on taming the cat will also work through the Ozolith to tame the other monsters. If he can do that, he can prove he's a loyal human and still impress General Kudrow. To be clear, at no point in the story does Luca ever consider the cat to be his friend or partner. He only sees it as a tool and later as a weapon. He shows it no affection and he never even gives it a name. All of which is in direct disagreement with the card Go for Blood, which implies Luca and the cat train together and become this awesome fighting force. Nothing remotely close to that happens in the book. The next card on the list is the Ozolith, and that lines up with when we learn about it in the book, as I just said. But this write-up says that the Ozolith is also causing sudden mutations, and the term mutate does not appear anywhere in the story. I only mention this because the set has like 35 cards that either mutate or care about mutating, so I consider it a pretty big theme of the set, but it's nowhere in the book. Anyway, Vivian and Luca reach the Ozolith, and the cards make it sound like they get there alone, but in the book, it's actually a major action piece as they are met by other bonders and their monsters, and the mercenary group catches up to them as well. In fact, that mercenary group is interesting and worth taking a moment to talk about. They're actually being led by a woman named Jurina Kudrow. She's the daughter of General Kudrow and Luca's fiance, which, again, is not mentioned anywhere in the cards. Jurina helps Luca escape Dranith, and then she's put in charge of tracking him down. The relationship between Luca and Jurina is a major component of the book, but it is nowhere to be found in the cards. And how do those mercenaries catch up to a flying cat monster anyway? Well, they hitched a ride on a ship after stopping at another sanctuary, a place called Skysail. While Dranith has its massive walls for protection, Skysail is a flying city. It's made up of balloons that hold together various platforms and baskets and bridges. So instead of enduring the monster attacks, it tries to evade them completely. The flying city is only in the book briefly, but it does give us some extra depth to the world of Ikoria, and you can see it represented on about a dozen cards within the set. Jarena, by the way, not in the set, although she does have a card in one of the commander decks being released alongside the set. So, anyway, the Ozolith, certainly a major turning point in the story because it speaks to Luca and it offers him access to its power. Now, Vivian realizes that another planeswalker is responsible for manipulating the Ozolith and using it to agitate the monsters, but that only happens in the book. The cards make it seem like this is how the Ozolith behaves normally. After communicating with the Ozolith, Luca realizes he can now bond with more than just the flying cat monster, and so his plan changes once again. He now wants to rally a whole army of monsters together and bring them back to Dranith to serve as defenders. He figures Kudra will be so impressed by this, he'll just open the gates and let them all into the city. And this is supposed to be represented by weaponize the monsters. The flavor text here talks about revenge, and I am not clear how that's supposed to fit into either version of the story. In the book, Luca is misguided, but he still wants to return to Dranith as a hero. And on the cards, he's had a different sort of adventure along the way, but ultimately still has the same goal. This is frustrating because now I feel like I have to pull threads from three different stories and keep tying them back together every time they start to fray apart. The next official story spotlight card is a perfect illustration of this, and that's Heartless Act. The art shows the flying cat monster about to be killed by an unidentifiable Dranith soldier with a quote from General Kudro. In the book, the cat monster saves Jarena at the Battle of the Ozolith and carries her all the way back to Dranith. Then the general orders her to kill it. She refuses because it saved her life, and she recognizes it is an extension of Luca's love for her. Then the general says, "Fine, I'll do it myself." And in the book, this is a significant event because it is the figurative severing of the general from his own daughter. Now on the cards, there is nothing to show how this cat wound up back in the city. There's nothing to show anyone argued to keep it alive. There's nothing to show General Kudro was the one willing to pick up the sword and do it himself to make a point. And on the website, it says that Vivian rallies with the Bonders to attack Dranith as if it's payback for this cruel act in killing a defenseless animal. But in the book, it's almost the exact opposite. She ends up standing with the Bonders in defense of Dranith alongside Jarena. The next card in the lineup is Ruinous Ultimatum, which is a bit of a stretch, but it does kind of fit with the book. Armed with the power of the Ozolith, Luca assembles an army of monsters and marches them on Dranith with the goal of removing General Kudro from power and saving the city. This is the final showdown in the book, and for me it's a bit of a disappointment. Early on, General Kudro remarks that Luca knows all of the city's defenses, and if he were to be working with the monsters, he would be practically unstoppable should he return and assault Dranith. So of course, when the time comes, Luca's attack on the city is described as, quote, "simple but effective." All he does is slam at the walls with his biggest and toughest monsters while he sends his flyers up over the top. Vivian and the Bonders do make an impact in the final battle, as implied on our next card, Lead the Stampede, but they were fighting from within Dranith the whole time, so their arrival was not a surprise. And this brings us to our final honorary story spotlight card, Unpredictable Cyclone. In all versions of the story, Luca pushes the power of the Ozolith too far. In all versions of the story, the Ozolith breaks, and the release of power overwhelms Luca, causing his spark to ignite and forcing him to planeswalk away at random. So that's where the story cards end, but the book keeps going. It tells us Luca arrived on an unnamed plane and was immediately attacked by three wolves. He realizes he still has some of the Ozolith power within him, and he's able to immediately bond with one of those wolves and turn it against the other two. Delighted to see he still has some power, Luca then vowed to eventually return to Ikoria and overtake Drannith with a new army of monsters. Meanwhile, Vivian leaves Ikoria in pursuit of whatever mysterious planeswalker had monkeyed with the Ozolith. And that's it. That's what happens in Ikoria, Lair of Behemoths, as told by three different sources. The story is about monsters. The twist is supposed to be that Luca ends up being the biggest monster of them all. If you just followed the cards, though, I'm not sure you'd really see that. Now, obviously, a book has a huge unfair advantage in telling a story over some 250 individual trading cards, but for whatever reason, the differences this time are really striking. Just like we had on Eldraine, a person playing only with the cards will walk away with a very different understanding of the story compared to someone who actually read the book. Even just looking at Vivian, who is a supporting character, consider the following. On the cards, she teaches Luca how to work with his flying cat, and she is mad at anyone who would ever harm one of the monsters. In the book, Luca and Vivian have several well-done scenes. At one point, they are attacked by a dinosaur, and working together, they manage to fight it off. Luca then wants to pursue it and kill it, and Vivian talks him out of it, saying every living creature has a right to defend itself, but not to kill without reason. That, to me, is really important because it is the foundation of Luca's new plan for protection. That is the moment when he switches from wanting to go beyond the walls to hunt monsters to using monsters as new walls, which is arguably a more peaceful form of existence. Now, it does hinge on using those monsters as slaves, which Vivian is against, and that becomes the core of their conflict for the later half of the book. They both meet other bonders, and Vivian immediately recognizes and respects the connection between man and monster, while Luca only sees it as a potential new weapon or way to increase his own strength. If you've watched any of my other videos, you know that one of my favorite ways to evaluate a character is to ask two simple questions. What does this person want? What are they willing to do to get it? Luca is actually asked this question in the book, so it's very easy to answer. While talking to the voice in the Ozolith, he tells it he wants to be strong enough to take what he wants. As for what he's willing to do, well, he's willing to accept the powers of the Ozolith without really understanding where they come from or what strings might be attached. And he's willing to use that power to enslave monsters, and he's willing to march those monsters against his own home city, and he's willing to kill his fiancé's father. Yes, that's right. In the book, Luca kills General Kudrow, and that's when Jarena realizes Luca is beyond saving and puts her effort into defending Drannith. She was willing to disobey her own father to try and save Luca, and in the end, that wound up not being worth it. But you would never know that just by reading the cards. Ultimately, to me, Luca is a villain, and not even one I can empathize with. Over the course of the story, we learn almost nothing about him. When he gets exiled, all he can focus on is getting back to Drannith, but we never really understand why that's important to him. In fact, early on in the book, he mentions how he never felt comfortable within the city. He prefers to be out in the wilds on the front lines against the monsters. We never learn anything about his romance with Jarena. We don't know how long they've been together. We don't know how they met. We don't really understand what they see in each other. All we're told is that they love each other, and that's supposed to be enough of a reason for Luca to be willing to march against Drannith with an army of monsters. Jarena ends up being one of the more interesting characters in the story, and so I'm kind of annoyed her card didn't make it into the main set. She's constantly torn between her loyalty and her duty and her respect for her father and her love for Luca, and in the end, she ends up losing both of them, and along the way, she has some really compelling moments. And she evolves from being an administrator inside the city of Draenneth to being a fighter out on the front lines. She displays her physical strength as well as her leadership abilities, and she proves after her father dies she is ready to become steward of the Sanctuary City. Narset is in the book, but only briefly. She is on Skysail buying a stack of books from a vendor there. And then towards the end, during the final battle, Vivian says she would ask Narset for help, but she doesn't know how to get a message to her in time. The Wanderer is not in the book at all. Neither are any of the named Apex monsters, although Luca does ride a giant turtle into his final battle. Let me be clear. I love the magic story. I really do. That's what this whole show is about. It's story time, eh? But if there was ever a set where they could have skipped an official story, it was probably this one. I mean, introducing a new planeswalker is great, and giving us a whole new world full of interesting legendary monsters, totally cool. I cannot deny that. But the whole lone soldier who goes crazy after touching a mysterious crystal and turning against the people he was sworn to protect thing, I feel like that was really wedged in there, and I don't love it. Humans trying their best to survive in a world ruled by monsters, already a very strong concept, and trying to focus in on just Luca and his broken quest for power kind of takes the spotlight off of what was already a really compelling setting. I don't want to end this video on a downer though, so let's have what will probably be the longest mustache minute we've done yet. Ready? Here we go. In the book, Luca surprises General Kudrow with a bunch of monsters coming up out of the ground at one point. One of them is an elemental stone octopus. It just grabs a bunch of copper coats and smashes them against his rock body. Where is that card? In the book, Luca is ready to sacrifice himself at one point to save a fellow squad mate. This is a woman named Effa, who does escape the flying cat monster attack, and then she's never seen again. She doesn't show up to try and look for Luca or prove that he's a good guy. She doesn't show up during the big final battle to defend Draenneth. She just vanishes. To Effa, the Fibblethip of Ikoria. In the book, they mention, but never visit, another sanctuary city, and that's Lava Brink, which is built on the side of an active volcano and is protected by a moat of lava. The people of Draenneth kind of look down on these guys because they think that they hide from problems rather than face them head on. Mind you, this is coming from the guys who send soldiers outside of their own city to hunt down monsters who are just minding their own business, and they have lost probably thousands of soldiers' lives doing that, but who am I to judge their methods? I hope you're not taking a drink every time I start one of these with "in the book," by the way. If I were going to cast Luca in a live-action magic movie, the only choice here is Sam Worthington. He's still around, right? If they gave me anything about Luca I could latch onto, I'd probably give them a pass. What's his favorite color? What's he like to eat? Does he have any friends or family in the city? What does he talk about with his barber when he's getting his regulation haircut? The dude's personality has so few notes, you could use it to compose the theme from Jaws. Who is the mysterious planeswalker that messed with the Ozolith, and why did they do it? I don't know. I have seen people speculate already that it is Oko once again, which I kind of hope it's not. I'd prefer it to be a new character. Plus, if it was Oko, all the monsters on the plane would be 3-3 elk by now, right? So in one scene in the book, Vivian fires her bow and out pops a dinosaur clearly from Ixalan. It is described as having bright, colorful feathers. But earlier in the book, every time she's used the bow, the creatures that come out are described as being green. Just solid green, just made out of green light. I've already done a video on who is Vivian, but I was not casting for my magic movie back then, so I do owe you a pick here. And I think for this role, I want to use Thandie Newton. She happens to be vegan, even. At the center of Draenneth, there happens to be another very large crystal. It's called the Argolith, and it's described as being the central part of their magical defenses against monsters. Is it connected to the Ozolith somehow? I don't know. Why would they give us two named crystals and have one be hugely important to the plot and the other just be set dressing? Why? Most of the monsters in the story are described as being the size of a horse. A few are as big as a house. The only truly big one we get is the giant turtle who shows up at the very, very end. The set is called Lair of Behemoths. And the book has... I know in the comments you're going to ask me how I would fix the Ikoria story, so I will give you my quick edit right here. Keep the beginning. Let Luca meet the cat and bond with it. That part's all fine. But then he's frustrated that the cat is pretty weak, so he decides to go and see if he can like trade it up for a bigger monster. He goes all the way to the five apex legends, and the first four of them all want nothing to do with him, but maybe he gets to the last one, Snapdax perhaps, and that one actually works. So then he's gonna bring it back to Dranith to show how powerful he's become. But meanwhile, Vivian goes around to the other four and kind of forms her own bond with them. Not quite the same way that Luca has, but she gets them to understand what's happening. So the four of them come in defense of Dranith, and now you have a four-on-one fight, but the bigger side is trying to minimize casualties. They don't want to kill anyone. They just want their brother back, although they have to stop Luca to do it. But Luca's team is out for blood to show how strong they are, so you get this really interesting final battle with the set piece still being the city and all the people in it wondering which monsters to root for. You could even have the Bonders in there, half of them signing up with Luca, to show how tough they are, and the other half fighting in defense of the city with the, you know, natural monsters. You'd have this crazy, crazy fight, and I think that would be my Ikoria. This set looks insane. I cannot wait to play with a companion mechanic and just break it until they have to ban every one of those suckers. What card are you most interested in playing with? Let me know down in the comments, and then make sure you like this video and subscribe to the channel so you don't miss the great stories you will only find here on Magic Arcanum. We'll see you.